order the committee of the whole meeting. We have four items on the agenda tonight. Master plan review, Cannondale Water Tower, Fire Station 15 construction update, For the Love of Renton follow-up, and then Republic Services negotiation update. I think I'm just going to go ahead and take them in that order if nobody has any objections. Okay, so let's get started with the master plan review.
Great. Before Chip jumps in, you recall in February, we met with you. We started the process of looking at the matrix that we presented, and this came about as a result of discussion you had in January, asking for a review of our master plan review process. So we presented the 43 plans, I believe, that we have that are currently underway in various stages of implementation, and wanted to get back to you now before we start into the budget process.
Right.
And see if there are any other specific information that you want with those plans. So Chip is going to review with staff each of those plans and where we are in terms of a review process, the status of those, and then we'll look to the council for you to tell us if you want us to make time between now and October 1st when we'll present the budget to you. If you want any more information on the plan or want any input into that plan so that it can be reflected in the budget, that's the purpose of trying to get this to you now.
Great. Thank you very much.
Great. Well, thank you, Council President Corman, members of the City Council, Chip Vincent from Community and Economic Development. In addition to what Jay said, what we've done, it's not in the PowerPoint, but we provided you last week an updated matrix that's consistent with the matrix that you were provided to the council retreat last February. With the exception, one of the questions that came out of the council meeting or council retreat back in February was, you'd like to see a line in here that showed the status of each of these documents. So I wanted to show you that this matrix has been updated now to show the status of each of the documents that we reviewed and discussed with you back in February. The goal tonight is to cover in a very high level some of the information in terms of the relevance and where each of these plans are. Look at the date of the plan adoption, the purpose of the plan. Look at what the entity is that's implementing the plan, whether it's Planning Commission, the Arts Commission, the Parks Advisory Board, Human Services Board, whatever entity. And then finally, look at the schedule to see where we are with respect to that plan, when it's scheduled to be updated, and so on. So what we've done in the interest of time is we've organized this into two meetings of the Committee of the Whole. Tonight, we're going to divide this up between Administration, CED, and Community Services Department. So the PowerPoint you have just covers those three departments, and I'm going to hand it off to my colleagues behind me in Community Services when I'm done with Administration and CED. We're going to come back to you on August 15th, and we're going to have Public Works, the Fire Department, and Administrative Services provide the same type of presentation, but we thought, in the interest of time, we'd organize this in a way that we don't overwhelm you with all these different planning documents where all the departments in the city are working on. So I'm going to kick that off here tonight, and beginning with the administration. And the one document that the administration is responsible for managing and working with the City Council is the city's business plan. The business plan, as you all know, is reviewed annually by the City Council, most typically at the retreat. The Council reviewed the business plan this last February at their retreat, and the next scheduled update to review the business plan is in the Council retreat in 2017. I will just say as a footnote that the business plan is really, it's not a required plan like many of these plans we're going to talk about tonight, but it's really an instrumental plan that's unique to the City of Renton that really guides a lot of the vision and the directions that the other planning documents we're going to talk about here tonight need to follow, to the extent that we've actually included it as part of the comprehensive plan now for the city. But it lays out a short-term visible actions for the city in terms of what our aspirations and goals are as a city. Moving on to community and economic development, the first plan that we work with is called the Renton Airport Compatible Land Use Program. This is actually a plan that's required by the state. Any jurisdictions that have general aviation airports that are designated as essential public facilities, which is a term of art under the state, are required to have an airport land use compatibility plan in place. What this does is it really governs the types of land uses and the height of those uses in our area around our airport to ensure that new development is compatible with takeoffs and landings at the airport. This is something that we look at both in terms of the airport master plan as well as our comprehensive plan for consistency and compatibility. We reviewed this as part of our GMA comp plan update last year, and it's consistent with that document today, and we did a finding to that effect. As Public Works goes through the update for the airport master plan, they'll be looking at the same program as well for finding a consistency. There is no required update to this plan. It's simply a plan you have to have in place if you have an airport that's general aviation and essential public facility. The next plan that we oversee in community and economic development is the Arts and Culture Master Plan. And this plan was first adopted in 2010, and it really provides the guidance for art and culture programs and events within the city of Renton. It is overseen and implemented by the Renton Municipal Arts Commission that recommends and advises to the city councils. This was scheduled for revision in 2015, but as you know, we've been working with the Arts Commission for several years now to fully fund the Arts and Culture Master Plan. So this is going to be coming back to you as a request. They've identified prioritized lists that we're going to share with you as part of the budget update this year in terms of how they would like to fully fund over time the Arts and Culture Master Plan, but there has been no need to do any updates to that plan at this point in time. The Benson Hill Community Plan was our most recent community plan that was adopted in the city. It was adopted in 2013. It's interesting because the first plan was a city center. This was the second. It was recognized by the city council at the time when this was initiated. Because this was a newly annexed area in the city, we had to figure out what the plan was for bringing this community in line with the rest of the city in terms of facilities and service delivery. The way to get there is through the community plan, and it really provides a blueprint for how growth, development, and services can be provided in that community. Just this recently, we established what's called a Benson Hill Plan Advisory Board that just this last month had their first meeting, and let me tell you, this is a robust group of organized individuals who really care and have a strong interest in the success of their community. We're actually having our next meeting August 18th, I think. So the ball is rolling on getting the citizens involved in implementing the plan. I will say while I'm talking about this that when the council has adopted community plans, it's been important for them to establish citizen stakeholders groups, because in a lot of these plans that I'm going to talk about tonight, these are long-term plans, 20-year plans, and there's so much in there, it can't be implemented all at once. So it really helps to have citizens deciding what the priorities are that can be recommended in advance to the council so we can begin ticking these things off that are important to the community one by one. It's important that the community see that progress is made, but it's important also for us as a city not to be overwhelmed by everything that's included in these plans by trying to do everything all at once. I should say on the last one, there's no requirement for updates to those for the community plans. City Center Community Plan was our first plan adopted in 2011, supplements and really refines a lot of the decisions made by the city in the comprehensive plan, guides growth for downtown, and similar to the Benson Hill Community Plan, we have a City Center Community Planning Advisory Board that meets every couple months here. And they provide an evaluation and recommendations to the city council for what their priorities are that should be implemented with the plan. And we're going to be bringing some of those recommendations forward. In fact, if you remember at your retreat, they had made a number of recommendations to you that we'll be bringing forward as budget recommendations this year as part of our budget discussion. And similar to Benson Hill Community Plan, there is no requirement to update that plan. We'll just continue implementing, updated as needed, as I should say. The Clean Economy Strategy is a plan that a lot of people are not familiar with. It was adopted in 2011, and it really provides really more an opportunity for the administration working with the budget to look at what are the goals for reducing our operating costs, emission reductions, energy savings, and funding opportunities to fulfill Renton's leadership in the sustainability area. This has really been used as one of the cornerstones in what's called the K4C group. It's the King County and the city's collaboration in looking at climate change related issues and how municipal governments can respond to this. This document has really helped us understand what it is we can do as a city. I will tell you the number one thing that we can do that came out of the strategy is frankly looking at our fleet. And the emissions that come from our vehicles are significant, and one of the recommendations is over time the transformation of the fleet to vehicles that have less lower emission standards. The comprehensive plan, and this is probably for CED the one you're most familiar with because it was the most recently adopted in 2015. It meets requirements of the State Growth Management Act, provides the blueprint for growth for our community, and it also requires periodic updates. I will tell you, we don't have to worry about this one for a while. Under the Growth Management Act, we have to update the comprehensive plan every eight years, so we're good until 2023. If anybody wants to put that on your calendars, I know Angie and I are going to. Anyway, a lot of work went into this. This is a three-year process going through this. Another document that CED is responsible for is the Shoreline Master Program, and this was last adopted in 2011. And I wish I could say this one wasn't due to be updated until 2023 like the comp plan. The state basically has these on eight-year cycles. We have not received notice from the state yet of when that next cycle is going to begin, but under statute, it's around 2018, I believe, the next update. This is a requirement of the State Shoreline Management Act that was adopted in 1973. It provides resource protection for our water. And we did something unique in Renton in that we incorporated the policies of the Shoreline Master Program. We included that as a chapter in our comprehensive plan. So we don't have a standalone Shoreline Master Program. It's actually integrated into our comprehensive plan.
Excuse me, Mr. President?
Yeah, Mr. Prince.
So Chip, I see on here no scheduled revision for the Shoreline Master.
Yeah. When we say no scheduled revision, they have it in statute, but typically what happens is that the State Department of Ecology actually provides funding to local governments and they stagger them. And we don't know how we're going to fall in line with other municipalities in central Puget Sound. Right now, in fact, we just received notice that DOE is looking at doing rulemaking in advance of the next update in 2017. But typically the way it's worked the last two times is DOE, the State Department of Ecology, will go into rulemaking to provide guidance for how jurisdictions need to do their updates and what needs to be considered. And they're just starting that process at the end of this year going into 2017. So that has to happen first before we know what the schedule is going to be. By the way, last time they were, I think, 2 years late in getting the DOE guidelines in place before we could start the process. Then the second thing that has to happen is the state, while they are not obligated to, they have historically provided funding to local jurisdictions because these updates are very costly. There's a lot of scientific analysis that's required associated with this. And so typically we receive a grant from the state for doing that. So those two things need to happen before we know what the schedule is going to be. But I can tell you right now in statute, it's scheduled for 2018, but we'll see what DOE finally says.
When you find out the date, will you let me know so I can be sick?
Okay. I'm actually
going to remember working on that on the Planning Commission.
That took
the better part of a year.
Yeah.
I want to say it was more than a year, and I will be checking my PERS pension plan to see when that date is as well.
Yeah. Well, that, Mr. Prince, I want to say I appreciate him bringing that up. I think it's a useful example, and to anybody that's watching this, we'd go bankrupt if we tried to update all of these plans every year because the amount of outreach and technical work we have to do every time we open one of these. So I think that, and I agree with you, that was a very painful one.
Too, Mr. President, if I could, one of the things we've tried to do in the comprehensive plan update is to take a look at these 43 plans and to the extent we can reflect those in various elements, as Chip said. In some cases, we added chapters in the comprehensive plan. In other cases, certainly in our capital facilities element and some of the other things, try to inform the comp plan with these other plans. So they're legitimate plans, and we don't just keep them on the shelf. We do try to make sure that we incorporate them because it is the policy direction you guys have given us.
Okay, good.
Yeah. And I should mention, since I'm talking about this, this is one of those plans that results in changes to our development regulations in terms of the width of docks, how long docks can be, buffers along shorelines, those very sensitive issues.
Riveting.
Yes. Okay, the Sunset Area Community Investment Strategy. This document is really the cornerstone of a lot of the work that's ongoing right now up in the Sunset community. It was adopted in 2009, and it really provides the prioritization for public investment in the Sunset area of the Renton Highlands. This is a document that's used by all the city departments, and it was really the basis and foundation for our HUD Choice Neighborhood Investment Grant that we provided to HUD earlier this year. And really provides the platform for how we can work with our public partners to really catalyze the investment that's going to initiate the kind of private investment that we'd like to see in this community. And then accompanying that, we followed up after the community investment strategy with a Sunset Planned Action Ordinance, which is both fulfills our obligations and responsibilities under the National Environmental Policy Act, as well as the State Environmental Policy Act. What it does is it evaluates all of the environmental impacts of new growth and development in the Sunset area, so we can accurately forecast what the mitigation or the costs are going to be for new development. It provides a way that we can do these analysis before the development occurs, so that we could front load the analysis so it doesn't take a lot of time after the fact. So typically the way it works in the planning process is you have a proposal that comes in, you evaluate the proposal, and then you do the SEPA analysis on the proposal. The Sunset Planned Area Action actually does it the opposite. We actually do the environmental review before the proposal comes in, so we've already evaluated the impacts so we can move through the process in a much more timely manner. You've actually had briefings. In fact, just 2 weeks ago, Raquel Timmons was here doing an amendment to this ordinance. This is something that we continually amend and supplement as projects or proposals come in that don't specifically fall within the range of evaluation that was done by the original SEPA planned action. And with that, unless you have any questions for the CED projects, I'll hand it over to our colleagues in community services.
Okay, thank you very much, Chip.
Thank you for going through that so fast.
Yeah.
Just whipping them up.
That was a nice presentation. Yeah. Any questions for Chip?
No.
Okay. Great.
Thank you, Council President.
One question, Chip. Is one everybody asks in town, and since we're talking about the plan, is when are we going to get a Trader Joe's?
Trader Joe's.
Yeah. Do we have a Trader Joe's plan?
You know, I will say, I have to say, we've gotten close. But at this point in time, I think we need a Trader Joe's plan. It's just.
That's Chip. We tell Chip, or Skip, Cliff, excuse me. Long day. Cliff, who skips to Chip's commands, if I can get that. Anyway, to Cliff, we say we need a Cabela's plan, we need a Trader Joe's plan, we need a Costco plan, we need any other plan that produces $1 million or more in annual sales.
Yes.
Those are the plans we need.
Kelly.
Ours doesn't include the Trader Joe's plan, so we apologize up front. Council President Corman, Council Members Kelly Beamer, Community Services Administrator. And as you can see, our team will be presenting the community services plans, and starting us off will be Leslie Betlock, and then for the recreation plan will be Mary Jane Ortiz, and then for human services, we've got Karen Bergsvik. And obviously through each of these Any questions you have, please stop us and we'll make sure and answer them for you.
Good evening, Council President, Council Members. We'll start off this evening with the Parks Planning and Natural Resources Division. So the Parks Recreation and Natural Areas Plan is actually an element in the citywide comp plan that Chip referenced earlier. This is a six-year plan that looks out to 20 years, and it's certified by our state granting agency, the Recreation and Conservation Office, for 6 years. So why do we plan? It's to stay current with community needs, and it sets a direction for long-term projects and goals for programming, property acquisition, development, and capital improvements. We identify priorities and funding strategies for critical elements of a livable community.
Mr. Person has a question.
I just want to clarify that one of the importances of this plan is that without this plan, we don't get the grants for the parks and stuff. So that's why this is a very, very important plan.
Exactly. Thank you. You took the words right out of my mouth.
I think I've heard it a few times. So, but I just want to be sure the public knew that.
Thank you. So when this is certified by the Recreation and Conservation Office, it is for 6 years. And actually, that's the only way that we can apply for grants through the state, either for state grants or federal grants managed by the state. But we also use this plan for King County and local grants as well. So since the plan was adopted in 2011, we do have it programmed for an update. We also have a budget request as part of the 2017 and 18 budget to increase the budget slightly. But we have increased our acreage by 39 acres to, we have about 1,225 acres now of parks and open space land here in the city of Renton. We've received $1.5 million in grant funding. And we've had three parcels donated to the city, totaling $715,000 because of this plan. The next document, the Urban and Community Forestry Development Plan. This is the first time that the city has had a formal plan that was adopted, and this was in 2009. So while the city has had a long history of managing to a lesser degree its urban forest, this plan sets out a 10-year strategy for how we move forward in the future. So for those of you who don't know, the city has 130,000 trees in its urban forest in parks, open space areas, and along road right-of-ways. This plan has enabled the city to obtain the Tree City USA designation for the eighth year and the Urban Growth Award for its sixth year. We've developed partnerships with nonprofit groups, a tree planting program, tree inventory and assessment reports that identify the trees and their species, as well as the quality of those trees, whether they're healthy or need some attention. A fee in lieu policy, and to date, we've received, actually last year, we received $500,000 in grant funding. The Trails and Bicycle Master Plan is another planning document that's recognized in the citywide comp plan, actually under two departments, under the Transportation Division, as well as Parks Planning and Natural Resources Division. This particular plan was co-led by Transportation and Community Services, with Transportation as the lead. And it's the first, to my knowledge, the only plan in the state of Washington that's a joint plan between two different departments that includes commuter bicycles as well as recreational trails. So it's quite a comprehensive plan. We also receive certification through our state granting agency, the Recreation and Conservation Office. And to date, since this plan was last adopted, we've completed land acquisition, numerous trail easements along the May Creek corridor, the Sam Chastain Trail. We just received our fourth and final trail easement from SECO Development for the Sam Chastain Trail, completed a portion of the Springbrook Trail Boardwalk, and grant funding. The Tri-Park Master Plan is It's really a subset of the Parks, Recreation, and Natural Areas Plan. This particular master plan was adopted in 2006, and it was part of a project done in concert with the Washington State Department of Transportation. And what initiated it was how to move commuters through this park-intensive corridor along the Cedar River, which includes Liberty Park, Cedar River Park, the Narco property where the temporary off-leash dog park is, and eventually for Washington State Department of Transportation to mitigate the impacts of widening the corridor through this area and relocating it. So with the adoption of this plan, there were over $11 million of mitigation that it has been documented that WSDOT will have to provide the city of Renton for impacts to these primarily three parks through this corridor. This particular plan does not include the 10-acre, this 10-acre where the three ball fields are, also known as the Merlino property, because there will be significant impacts to the active recreation in these three parks. The impacts were documented in a letter of concurrence, also on file as part of the environmental impact statement process. The Sam Chastain Waterfront Trail was adopted in...
I do have a question about the Tri-Park Master Plan. Mm-hmm. Say that the revision is not changed and may need to be revised when transportation funding becomes available and or the corridor improvements are modified. When are we going to revise the Tri-Park Master Plan since, you know, right now things are changing around 405?
Well, while I-405 is changing, it's the footprint of I-405 is not changing within this segment. And so once additional lanes are added and or the alignment of 405 is relocated, actually it was originally planned to be shifted to the west or toward Liberty Park, at that point in time, we will likely take a look at this master plan because it's adopted to have, right now the plan is 10 years old, and there's no identified schedule or funding for the improvements within this area where the parks are, that it's likely this plan could be up to 20, maybe even 30 years old before it could be implemented. And so because it was part of an environmental impact statement, which is a very public process, and the master plan process itself is a very public process, things change, needs change. We would want to involve the community again to take a look at this plan.
Okay, but just correct me, Greg, that you're here. There are no plans for adding lanes to the 405 or to move or if you may. Because maybe I don't know the answer.
Well, not at this point in time.
Yeah, I might be able to help out. I see Greg standing up. But so the 405 working groups, and there were three of them. There was a citizens committee, there was a staff committee, and then there was an executive committee that came up with a long-term vision for I-405. And that vision called for two new lanes each direction on 405. And that plan still exists. It is the documented long-term plan for 405, and that would expand the footprint of 405. Right now, the state is saying that they can only afford to add one of those lanes each direction, and that they can do that within the existing footprint. So this plan wouldn't kick in with the construction that's in progress now. I see that I've got that right. That
yeah.
Greg agrees. So, longer term, I've been on that 405 executive committee for over a decade. I think it would be, realistically 10 or 15 more years before the state would come forward with the money. I in some ways regret that. I mean, the original plan with two new general purpose lanes each way would probably help a lot of commuters on 405, but that's not what's going to happen now. So it's going to be a long time, I think.
Thank you, Leslie.
The Sam Chastain Waterfront Trail, this plan was adopted in 2003 with the long-term goal of connecting the Cedar River Trail. The Cedar River Trail over here at the mouth of the river, and I'm not sure I'm pointing to it correctly, over to Coulon Park. So with the adoption of this plan, the city has in fact acquired 4 easements from the Southport. I'm not able to show the arrow on the plan, with the Southport CECO development property. And so in, thank you, Kelly. We also have an agreement with the State Department of Natural Resources. While they have done mitigation on that site for the 520 bridge, we do have approval from, again, our state granting agency, the Recreation and Conservation Office, to construct a trail on that the green area north of the Boeing plant, to construct a trail there in the future. We would have to mitigate. We would be mitigating impacts to the wetland and natural area creation that was done as part of the 520 bridge project, which then leaves one missing segment, and that's in front of the Boeing property, and that would be connecting over to the existing trail. So this plan is it's a long-term vision. I'm ever hopeful that one day we will have that connection. Because of the adoption of this plan, we did secure $1 million in grant funding. It ultimately was turned over to complete a portion of the Lake Washington Loop Trail because we weren't able to get some of the agencies on board with completion of this plan. And the Sunset Neighborhood Park Master Plan. So this is another tier down from 2 of the plans that Chip talked about, the Sunset Area Revitalization Plan that was completed in 2009, the Sunset NEPA document that was adopted in 2011, and this is for the development of a future 3.2-acre park within the same Sunset area. This was adopted in 2014 and will include phase development, most likely 3 phases. We received a $1.7 million grant from the Department of Commerce to construct phase 1, which will occur in 2017. We are approaching 60% design for that. We are also in process of submitting three grants totaling $2.3 million to the state granting agency, the Recreation and Conservation Office, for federal and state grants. And if successful, if not successful, we've put in a budget request so that we can continue with phase 2 design and phase 2 development to occur in 2018, which would leave a third phase in 2019. And before we move on, if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer any questions on these plans.
Good afternoon, Council Member and President, our members. Senior Business Plan. This was adopted in 2015. This was based off of the census at the time for 2010. 20% of our seniors were over the 50-plus population. So this is a guiding plan for us to make business decisions, investments, as well as how we determine our programming. A few things that we've adopted since we've done the business plan is we've extended our Wednesday night hours to accommodate our boomers who are still working seniors. So we are now open until 9 p.m. on the fall, winter, and spring hours. We also are looking at expanding how we're servicing all of our seniors. So we do have an LGBTQ support group that's for free, and that is another way that we're expanding that demographic, that it's not just by age, but lifestyle, culture, ethnicities and interests as well. So this is a nice new addition that we had. Also, on October 8th, we're doing our 50-plus Senior Resource Expo, and this is going to be a great way to showcase what the Senior Center has to offer, as well as what we do in partnership with our community members, and local businesses that particularly serve our seniors. Go ahead, that's dry for me. So we are up for reaccreditation this coming spring. We were the first in Washington to become an accredited agency. This is, I think, a huge feat. Soon after, it was Bellevue and Tacoma Metro, but we still get to say that we were the first. It is a 5-year renewal cycle. This keeps us up with standard industry for the recreation and parks field. It keeps us up with trends. It keeps us up with emerging issues, I could say, whether it be legal, public interest, and it also helps us collect data on how we're servicing the public. This is important when we're trying to obtain sponsorship as well as apply for any future grants. The recreation plan, which is a sub plan of the parks, recreation, and trails plan, we definitely utilize this, and along with the city's business plan, to make sure that, again, the programs and services that we're offering are speaking to the public's needs, interests, as well as making sure they meet the city's guided recommendations. Currently, for our marketing plan, we don't have a structured and specific plan. These are the marketing tools that we use to reach the public. We do look at our analytics regularly to assess on how our marketing is working, whether our graphics are reaching the audience and capturing their attention. We also look at how much people are participating in our programs. And we do this by digital analytics of our program guides, as well as analytics on Facebook and open rate and click rate when we send out our Renton Community Services newsletter. So in the meantime, we're definitely working with analytics and working with the communications division to formally create a marketing plan. Lastly is our cost recovery guide plan. This is how we determine what fees we are charging for our programs and services. And this also helps us to determine how much we need to subsidize through sponsorships and as well as through cost recovery. So if the program is primarily benefiting an individual, we need to have a high cost recovery. If it's a large community benefit, such as our special events, there's a lower amount that we need to recover, but we do work our hardest to obtain as much sponsorship as possible to cover that cost. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Karen Bergswick, the Human Services Manager. I have two plans, so I'm going to be very short. The first one is the community needs assessment for human services and housing. We did this so that we had a common set of demographics for the housing and human services element of the comprehensive plan. We realized in the different departments that we were using different data and that it would be good that we use the same data. So this is the first needs assessment that had ever been done for human services and housing. They used it in the Choice Neighborhood applications, and we also use it in our human services funding deliberations. That plan identified 13 area of needs, and there's five. We broke them out into 5 broad areas, and that's what we use for people to apply to us for funding, this funding cycle. We expect it's going to be updated at the same time that the comprehensive plan is going to be updated, if not before. We don't have a set date for updating it at this time. The second plan is the Human Services Strategic Plan. It's still in draft form. I'm completing it as we speak, and it should be done by the end of the year. I see this plan as taking us from where we are, which is the data, to where we want to be, which is the housing and human services element and the policies in that. And this is sort of the bridge for the next 4 to 5 years as far as how we're going to get from where we are to where we want to be. And like I said, it should be done here shortly. We want to update it every 2 years in sync with our funding cycle for human services. Any questions?
Any questions from council on any of these sections, like community services? Terrific job. So, first time in my memory I where we've put all these plans together like this and laid it out. I think it's very interesting.
Yeah, I think starting this year, I think we, in February, I think what we'll try to do is at least every 6 months give you guys a status report, and then as we move forward, obviously with updating the plans individually, we'll keep
you up. Kind of at the start of each year, maybe sort of hint at which ones are going to be big and that for that year. But.
So we'll be back, as Chip said, in 2 weeks with the rest of the story, if you will, and go through the remainder of the plans, give you a status report and update, and get any feedback from you on anything you want to drill down on before the budget.
Great. Well, thank you. Okay, so should we go on to the next item? Kennedale Water Tower Fire Station 15 construction update.
Council President Corman and council members, Kelly Beamer, Community Services Administrator. I'm here to introduce and maybe tell some stories while we're getting projection up. Introduce Michael Kirk, our Facilities Director. And Michael will be presenting the Fire Station 15 portion of this, and then we'll pass it on to Public Works.
See if you can work that.
Yes. You want to do it up here?
Yeah.
You want me to do it for you?
Yeah, you can do it
sure.
For me.
Kelly's going to be the official pointer, is that?
Oh, yeah.
Hopefully. Okay.
Nope, that's there.
That's the last one. Oh, you need to find this. Let's find the next one. There we go.
All right.
I need this whole thing.
All right. Well, thank you very much for this opportunity. We're extremely excited in facilities to be working with the Regional Fire Authority on this project. We think it is a very important project, and what I wanted to do is do a quick update for you tonight. First, I wanted to talk about the property history. As you can see that this property was acquired back in 2001, and a lot of due diligence and a lot of work by the fire department was done to make sure that they could find a property that would meet their needs and that would be located strategically to be able to service the community. And so they went about doing a search and identified this particular property, and the property was identified because of the growth in the area as well as demand on services from the fire department at the time that required them to purchase a property and plan for a future fire station. As we move forward, our focus from a project management standpoint is about people, process, and place. There are a number of stakeholders that will participate in helping us not only develop the concept but also helping us deliver the project. As you can see that you'll be involved in, we'll have a team of hired people that will help us with the concept design as well as the design and construction. And along the way it will be a very engaging, stakeholder engaging type process. We want to get the perspective from a number of people that would have end users of the particular project, the building that we would build, the fire station. And in that, we will also have time where we will get input from our citizens as it relates to the development of the design. The place of this is in the Kennedale area. It's adjacent to two commercial parcels, as well as having a residential piece of property behind it. What we plan on doing is with that is to engage the citizens and get their input as we further develop the project. Here's an example. Right now, the Regional Fire Authority is in a process of evaluating what exactly their needs will be, and what we're showing here is a two-bay station as well as a three-bay station. And they're making decisions on which one would be the better one to fit their needs in that particular area. Once that is determined and we hire an architect, then we will take that information and develop a building and a site plan to place that fire station on the property. As it relates to the project, the scope, the budget, and the schedule, like I said, it's a 2 or 3 bay satellite station that will be roughly around 7,500 square feet. The budget for the capital budget for the project is $5.5 million. The way that we operate is just because we have $5.5 million doesn't mean that we're going to utilize all those dollars. We're going to look for every opportunity to build that as efficient and as cost-effective as possible. So throughout the design as well as construction, we'll be looking for opportunities to cut down the costs. And then once it's built, we foresee that the annual operation and maintenance costs will be roughly about $32,000. That'll cover for utility costs, for the regular operations of keeping it clean, keeping it safe, as well as cover the maintenance costs that are associated with this type of facility. For our schedule, we're looking for starting in January of 2018 and by December of 2018 completing that construction and turning that over to the Regional Fire Authority. As we approach the design, our design approach will be first the total cost of ownership. When we look at the developing of the plans for this building, we'll be looking at not only the capital costs, but also our decisions in the capital, how that will affect our operation and maintenance costs. And so what we're looking to do is kind of get a best value between making very, very good decisions around our design that will cost us less as it relates to our operation and maintenance cost in the future. So it's sort of like a balanced decision making of not only looking at the capital, but also looking at the future costs of operation and maintenance. But then also our approach will be around sustainability, and that we'll be looking and making decisions that the things that we choose as far as the finishes, the materials and stuff, that they are durable and that they will be as less maintenance free as possible. But also we'll be looking at the environmental impact of such a facility, not only in the immediate area, but as that footprint, carbon footprint throughout the carbon footprint of the facility and its impact on our environmental. And then we're also looking for a facility that's high performance, and that comes in two ways. And one is that it's efficient, not only efficient as it relates to the day-to-day operations, but also efficient from the sense of the various types of systems that we will place into or design into the facility. But first and foremost, our focus will be on working with the Regional Fire Authority to make sure that the building is functional and it meets their needs. And so that's gonna be our main focus, is that it will be functional and meet their needs as they move into the building and operate from that building. At this time, I'll turn it over to our water department, because this is a joint project, and that project will also include a project from the water department.
Any questions for community services on the fire station portion?
Mr. President?
Yes.
I actually don't have a question for the community services. I was just wondering what process the fire department's going through to determine if they're going to use 2 bays or 3 bays.
Members of council, Mark Peterson, fire chief. Right now we've sent the plan, the 2 bay and the 3 bay, out to all the response operations personnel to get their feedback. And we've assigned a battalion chief to be the lead on getting all that information back and looking at some of the issues and some of the concerns that everyone has.
Thank you.
I have just one question.
Here, Mr. Person.
Is there any possibility that this could be completed before December 2018?
Yes, we could possibly finish it before that time, but we're working with the Regional Fire Authority and trying to balance it out with their schedule as it relates to their operating the facility, because we didn't want to build it too early and they're not ready to operate it. And so if that changed, then we could possibly build it a lot quicker.
Thank you.
Good.
Any other questions about the fire station?
Mr. President, if I could, I'd just say, as the water department's coming up, I think, you know, we're still in the process of just preliminarily working through some of the plans of this. It is a joint effort to try to see if we can't co-locate our water tower there with the station, but we are very, very aware of the promises made to the public with regard to Station 15, and so we want to really hold to those timelines. It does create some challenges trying to do both projects, and we're working that through, but we'll be back to you periodically is when we get a little bit more information to give you, make sure the council's kept apprised of this, as well as the RFA board, so they're aware. But we recognize the priority here is the station. That's the priority. That's what we bought the property for. That's what we told the public we were for. So that's the priority, is to get that station done.
Can you follow up on that by reminding me, was there a, have we advertised a specific schedule to the public for that fire station?
Just in our, in discussing it with the community and providing facts, we told them that what we were going to try to do was, you know, part of the issue that went before the voters was additional resources to build and construct a station. And we indicated that we would retain some funds, the city would retain some funds in the first year after the authority came into play to provide the funding for the station. Okay. We didn't give a time specific, okay, but I think the expectation was we would get on the station soon.
We would get on it. Okay, good.
Mr. President?
Yes, Mr. Prince?
And Jay, I'm glad you said that, because that's exactly what I was thinking about, the promise we made to the voters and what the priority is, because I know there are folks up on in Kennedale that have been clamoring for this fire station for quite some time and had some angst over the RFA because they wanted the fire station. So I'm glad that you reiterated that the priority is the fire station.
Good. Okay. Go on to the water tower aspect.
Yeah. Council Chair, Council Members, my name is Abdul Ghaffour with the City Water Utility Department. I'm here to give you a briefing on the proposed water reservoir in the Kennedale area next to the Fire Station 15 site. And three questions that I will hope to answer to you today is, why do we need a reservoir in the Kennedy area? Why do we need a reservoir at this site? And lastly, why do we need it now? So as part of a system planning, we look at making sure that the city has enough storage for fire protection, for domestic use. And also, we look at providing reliability to the system and redundancy. Currently, the water to the Highlands, I mean to this Kennedy area, is being stored at the Highlands site on Northeast 12 in Monroe. We have three tanks there, two underground, one elevated, that were built back in the early 50s to the 60s. Mm-hmm. And so to get water to the Kennedy area, we have transmission line that cross I-405 at two locations, one at North 30th Street Bridge, underneath the bridge, and one under 405 near 26th Street Extension. And so the water does travel a ways to get from the Highlands to the Kennedale area, okay? And there is no storage tank in the Kennedale area at the moment. So as part of our planning process, we look at, you know, building reliability in the system. When can we put reservoir? When do we need a reservoir? So just to give you a quick update on a quick summary of the Kennedale area, how large it is. Right now, the Kennedale area that we're looking at putting a tank has about 926 single-family dwellings, okay? 1,700 multi-family dwelling units, 44 commercial customers, 20 industrial, 40 irrigation, 61 fire protection service, and 9 city connection. And our customers include the Boeing Company, the Packard Kenworth plant, the Landing Development, Southport Development, Seahawks Facilities, and Stoneway Concrete. So there's a lot of water need in that area for both domestic need and also for fire protection. And in addition, since we don't have a reservoir in the Kennedy area, occasionally we experience water hammers from water users, you know, that go off and on for a short period, and that cause fluctuation in system pressure, and it cause water hammer that eventually can cause damage to pipeline or plumbing. So having a tank in the same area allow a dampening of the surge pressure in the water pipe, because it right now is a closed zone. So that's one of the reasons to have a reservoir in the Kennedale, is to provide surge protection in addition to having a more reliable location of a tank. And why do we choose this site? I look back in our system planning, in 1983 system plan, there was an identification that we need to have a reservoir in the Kennedy area, but not at this site, anywhere that we can find land suitable to put a reservoir, the right elevation, the right size, and proximity to the area being served. So we expressed interest in this site many, many years ago, but we cannot go ahead and build a tank until we have a project by the fire department, fire authority, to build it, the station so we can go in at the same time. And so we have selected a consultant to do the pre-design for the tank, including a major portion on public outreach. The consultant contract is being submitted to council for approval this evening, but you know, we will wait to see if you have any questions first on this contract. The reason we want to design and build the tank now, because it will be a huge cost saving to the city. We have joint site work, joint street improvements, landscaping, storm detention facility that can be constructed at the same time for both facilities. And also the permitting process, the reservoir project, we need to go through a land use permit application, including a conditional use permit, site plan approval, and you know, geotech report so far. So we can be, a lot of joint material can be used for both projects. With that, the council, any questions on the timing or space? So this rendering is very conceptual. You know, the real rendering will be developed during the pre-design stage, and we will look at public comments on aesthetic placement of the tank, landscaping requirement, land use requirement before we can finalize the aesthetic of the tower. So please do not take this as the final version of the tower.
I was just going to ask some sort of engineering related questions. Yes. So obviously it's very tall, and you know, my biggest concern about it is going to be the shadowing of the nearby homes. The 120 feet, is that a hard and fast requirement? I mean, I know that you need height to get pressure.
Yes.
But I presume in a fire or whatever, this tank gets drawn down and you're not at full height, presumably after you've fought part of a fire. So I don't know.
You are correct. Basically, Councilor, is that we need to provide a minimum of 30 PSI at the highest house. But that's a criteria that we like to, there's a policy to provide 30 PSI at the highest home, and also 20 PSI during a fire suppression event.
I see.
So that's the critical, so the elevation of the water overflow is 320 above sea level. But the height of the tank may be a little bit higher than 100 feet because we have to allow room for sloshing for, you know, and roof type. So the 100 foot would be the minimum to provide from ground level to provide the 30 PSI at the highest home. And by the time you add the roof, depending how much slush room you want to have freeboard, it could be 120, but it'll be looked into, you know, more detail when we do the design.
Yeah, Mr. Person.
I guess one of the best things I can equate this isn't being a fire department question is when the glass place burned down here, how many thousands of gallons a minute were you pouring on that fire? Do you have any? I heard it, and it was an excessive amount.
Yeah.
Help me out, Rick. But I believe at one point in the height of the fire, we were putting close to 4,000 gallons per minute on that fire.
Wow. So I think that gives a good idea to the public of why this water storage is so important. Thank you.
And we will be working with the Art Commission to make sure that the aesthetic, you know, will meet the city's requirement and the community requirement. So that's a very important element of our outreach. Typically, we would submit the permit first and get comments. In this project, we will go to public outreach first and foremost to get all the comments, input, and we report back to council before we submit a complete application.
See,
preliminary schedule in front of you, Council, and so we're trying to, again, to the extent we can, cooperate and coordinate with the fire station for an efficiency standpoint, as Abdul mentioned. But we are providing for a lot of public outreach just to inform the public about this, because there will be lots of interest, as has been mentioned, and hopefully not a lot of controversy, because it is a central public facility. So we're trying to work this through so that we can work both the tower and the fire station, construct them in a compatible way. But we're looking, as you can see, in these timelines. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Do it.
All right. Well, thank you for the update. We'll look forward to hearing more about how it's proceeding.
Thank you.
Right.
Okay. So then that moves us on to the third item on the agenda for the Love of Renton follow-up.
We'll do a little palate cleanser here. We're talking about all these serious issues, so uh-huh. Christy's going to bring us some fun stuff.
I'm clearing the room, so. I will only be talking about half the time. I have a lot of video clips to show you of other people speaking, so you don't have to listen to me too much. But thank you, Council President Corman and council members, for this time. I am Christy Rowland. I work in the finance department. One of my projects is I lead the Renton Results Initiative here, the vision of which is to improve the overall quality of life for citizens. That's a very grand vision, but it is nonetheless very important, and it's something that leads into one of our priority emphasis, which is our quality of life levy coming up. So that's the connection between Renton Results and this work. This was made possible by our partnership with the Government Performance Consortium. So we as a city participate in this group that also involves the UW, University of Washington, the MRSC, State Auditor's Office, the Local and Government Performance Consortium, or Improvement Center, LGPC. So they generally underwrite all of the big ticket items so that we can bring these amazing people to our events. The events that we have put on so far, we've had Ken Miller here with the GPC partnership. Ken Miller, you might have heard of him. He's the author of Extreme Government Makeover. Highly recommend it. It's a great, great book. We've had Rebecca Ryan here, who's a futurist, and she focuses on 30, 40, 50 years into the future, beyond the comprehensive plan, beyond our business plans, and kind of getting cities and jurisdictions thinking way far forward, what's coming our way. And the last one we had was Peter Kagiyama. He wrote the book For the Love of Cities, and that was the stepping off point of our Love of Renton Week. And so all of these people came to speak at a forum. We call it a GPC, Government Performance Consortium Learning Forum. They're open to all local jurisdictions, primarily focused on local government, but the idea behind it is to lift up and improve government, the perception of government, and the effectiveness of government in a variety of different ways. So we've had three of them so far. This one was on May 10th, on Tuesday, and you can see we had about 15 of our staff show up for our own learning forum here at the pavilion. We also had a speaker by the name of Mr. Jay Covington. He actually presented what is wonderful and lovable about Renton. And also two other speakers presented at this forum. Then we had part of the deal with Peter Kagiyama was that he not only would do the half day forum, but he was going to spend time in three different cities, just kind of sending his message, learning about us, and sharing with different people whatever we lined up for him. He spent a day in Squim, he spent a day in Tacoma, and he spent a day here in Renton, and it was his favorite day. We kept him very busy. We started him at 9 in the morning doing a tour of the things that are already existing, love notes, as he calls them, in Renton, things that people love about this place. We took him to the Meadowcrest Playground. We took him to La Crosse Community Gardens. He spoke with the people who organized that. We took him, of course, to Coulon, to our library. We took him to the Talbot Hill Neighborhood Sign, and that was a wonderful kind of demonstration of city staff working with the neighborhood people. We had our neighborhood coordinator, Casey Stanley, working with our public works streets maintenance supervisor, I think he is now, Patrick Zellner, who they actually coordinated a special pickup for the neighborhood because the neighborhood wanted it to be really nice and sharp for Peter's visit. So it was just a great demonstration of cross-departmental coordination there and working with the citizens. So we took him on a tour and showed him all about our wonderful city. And then we brought him back for a lunch. We had over 90 staff members coming on their own time to listen to Peter's message. And it was a very short version of his overall message. But in the bottom line was him posing to all city staff at any project, and we just heard a whole list of plans. Anytime you're doing some of these things, asking the question, where is the fun? So the idea behind, there's an opportunity for the city at every turn to surprise and delight citizens. And so to build that into the plans as you're working on them. And so many people that came to this and that I work with all the time love and are passionate about their work, but it was really exciting to see the connection they saw to that message. I'm going to just share with you about 2 minutes of some of the staff's response to the question, what I love about working for Renton. This was immediately following the TED Talk.
I love the community that the city is in terms of the citizens and the makeup of the community, the residents as well as the commercial and business base. I also love the employees that I work with and the their dedication to the community and the city and how you can see their love for what they do in their job.
City of opportunities. And I was given a opportunity to work here 32 years ago. I enjoyed it. I never regret a day in my life. And I wish I can have more people who would give it a try to work in public sector and find out that it's a very good job as long as you're motivated and enjoy the people you work with.
Flexibility that people have in looking at our processes and how we do things and the ability to maybe look at things differently and how we might organize our structure, put people in different places where they'd be most utilized and more to make a more efficient and effective process for developers to come in and make a project that will actually be proud of.
I love our employees. I think we have the best dedicated employees throughout the whole area. I mean, they're wonderful, they do wonderful work, and they really care about our city and our citizens.
And what do you love about Renton?
What I love about working in Renton is the people. I have never worked in a place that has such warmth and connection between the people. I've never had a job where I even socialized with my coworkers before. I'm kind of an introvert. So for me, what's really great about Renton is I form relationships and I form very, very strong friendships here. And that helps things work together better when we're working on projects together.
You know, there is an exceptionally good group of people that work at the city of Renton. You know, oddly, I discovered I really like working with the police. Our police are just great people. And you know, everyone else is okay.
Great. That was just wonderful.
That was fun.
Yeah, good. So after that, we had, most of you were in attendance. We had an opportunity to sit down with Peter and pick his brain. I think one of the biggest takeaways for me here at this leadership discussion was the validation that came from a lot of the ideas he was posing we're already working on. So that's a really nice validation of the efforts we're already doing. And then there were some pretty good ideas thrown out too that will be chewed on hopefully in the months to come. So then we kept him hard at work sending him over to the back to the pavilion for our evening event. At that event, we had over 125 people attend from the city residents, and we invited our commissions, our boards, our task force, people we knew were already engaged. This was kind of an experiment. We really didn't know what we were going to get out of this, so we knew we wanted the people that were already engaged in the city to just kind of feel this out and see how it would go and see the response we would get. But it turned out really to be wonderful. We had Benita Horn emceeing for us, and she did a fantastic job. And we also had a graphic artist recording this event. You've hopefully all seen the wall of love that's in the hallway now on the way to your office. And if you read it left to right, that was the night. It was a great way to demonstrate that. We did encourage people to mix it up, so while people were coming with their neighborhood groups or their boards or their usual party goers, we actually tried to mix them up and ask them to sit at separate tables so they could at least cross-pollinate a little bit some of their ideas and get some fresh thoughts and perspectives. And I think that went pretty successfully. One of the activities that Peter directed them through is just to come up to the mic and voice out what they love about Renton. And that was really a wonderful exercise. You can see the word cloud here. If the number of times something was repeated, the larger the word is in this word cloud. And you can see a lot of what people love about Renton are actually past city investments. So these are things we keep in mind as we plan our budget and look forward to making sure that we continue to provide things that people love. Now I'm going to just give you another video clip of some of the interviews we did. I have all of the interviews, but I just tried to splice together some that speak to this question: what makes Renton the best city in King County? And just so you know, the Budget Advisory Committee also viewed this video as well.
I think the thing that makes it the best city in King County is that it has a very deep past, but it also has a commitment to its present, making our lives as citizens it's such a rich place to live. And then also, the thing I love about the city is the city staff and the people who run the city are always thinking about the next step and into the future. So it's a place to be now and a place to plan for and to be in the future.
I think what makes it the best is the community activities that we have that embraces all people. I think some of the community programs that we have that promote the wellness and health of people and the cleanliness of the people, of the city, and especially the parks and things where people can gather as family. And
Without a doubt, it's the people. It's that wonderful, warm feeling. And that's what we have in Renton. We're rich in people.
I think the diversity of Renton makes us the best. And what I mean by diversity in Renton is that we can all live together in so many different areas of Renton.
Well, I think that it has many good things going for it. But right now in particular, I think that with the high price of housing and rent in Seattle in particular, it really has an opportunity to allow people to come here and be new homeowners. It's a great city in that regard, and I think that's kind of what makes a community in some ways is the permanence of its residents. So Renton is one of the few places where you can actually afford to buy a home if you live on a reasonable salary, and you still want to be close into to Seattle. Yeah.
It's the people. We are one of the top diverse cities in the county, and I'm very interested and involved in diversity at work. And then I come home and I bask in it when I get here. The face of Renton has changed since the 70s. Started to see a change in the early 90s. I would say about the late 80s, and it has gotten mellower. It has gotten more diverse, the populations. There is so much richness when people have a lot to share, because not everyone's thinking alike, not everyone's looking alike, not everybody is doing the same thing. There's adventure. It's the kind of thing that lifts you up and makes you want to leave the house, you know, to meet new people. And that's what I love about Renton, the richness of its population.
I love so many things about Renton. I think it's our city. It's the city government. It's the festivals. I mean, we've got Gene Coulon Park with the fireworks, and we have the clan lights. There's tons for you to do with your family. Those traditions make a big deal, are a big deal for me.
I think this is the best city in King County. First of all, they are working for the welfare and betterment of the whole community. That's why it's voted one of the best cities in the whole United States.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Good.
Oops. So then what the next activity that we did was a t-shirt slogan contest, and that was really to focus and zero in on what people felt like was the best part of Renton. What makes Renton Renton? So at the tables, each of them came up with a design. It was a silly, fun thing to do, but it really did come up. They did come up with some great ideas, and you'll see a lot of them on the Wall of Love. You'll see there are some that we obviously couldn't participate in as a city and support, but they were still great ideas. The one, and we actually had them win, and on the fly, Ms. Kelly Beamer actually suggested, hey, why don't we produce the winning t-shirt? So thankfully, a good one that we could produce was selected by the room. They all voted and picked this one that you see here. We love our curves. This is a prototype. It hasn't quite been finished yet, but it'll be available at the farmer's market for sale soon. So hopefully you'll see that, and you'll see them around town. And it's just another way to remind each other how much we love Renton. And you can see on the right there, the Flying High. That was another one that came out of a table. And that one's already been designed and put up for sale. So you might see those around town. And that came right from this event, right from a table exercise. Then we moved on to a $500 idea, and that's something that Peter does as part of his presentation. And that is to say to a group, if you had $500, what would you do right now to make a difference in your city and show the love of your city? So creating a love note of some sort, what would you do? Every table came up with ideas, and the winning idea happened to be a little bit too big. So this was part of our learning process. We weren't too clear enough on the scope that they took on this big project that someday will happen, either this year or next year, but they want to do a motorized or non-motorized do the loop. So this is a fantastic idea built on history, and but doing a non-motorized version will bring in more people into the downtown area and just kind of lingering around the downtown. So there's this fantastic idea, a little bit too big for the do it right now kind of idea, but nonetheless a great idea that came out of it. The second place winner was actually came from, so we all voted, and first place was the do the loop. Second place was one called Positive Works, which actually came from a city employee in our public works department who was attending as a resident, but he wants to do things such as stamping positive messages into the sidewalks. Those were things that Peter was suggesting and other cities are doing, and so that's going to work its way through. And then we had a third place, which was to project images of Renton amenities onto the City Hall facade at night so people driving by can see. These are just ideas that came up, and there was just a ton of those ideas. So every table had a great idea, and you can see them on the wall. The idea is that they do them, and that the city may kind of set the table creating the opportunity, but they're doing it. So not a we need more to do kind of thing, but we want to help you do this. So we did then ask the question, you know, how do you feel about doing this? What would it take? You know, what kind of support do you need from the city? And how do you feel about taking action? And this is one more short video clip about what they had to say.
being involved in a number of different boards and commissions with the city, I think it now becomes our commitment to take what it is that we've learned here tonight and to support folks at every level in the community, whether they're doing this work or not, support their ideas and try things that are outside of the box.
Probably involvement of different groups. I mean, there's a lot of risk taken, so I think just different community groups getting together and stepping forward and taking action.
Sharing with people about renting and about how we work together with the police department and the fire department and all these different people on the committees that I'm on. And so to me, the love note that I say for renting is the love note is that you can live here and you can feel like you're loved, not just by people who look just like you, but by those that are also in your community that serve you. So that would be my love note.
Our physical spaces and the idea that anyone can create art, that you know it brings joy to someone in the moment. So I would love us to do more of that.
No, we have so many opportunities to serve here that are fantastic. I think REACH has a lot of those. We feed the hungry, and we take care of the people who are desperate, and we do it as friends, as just people here. And the city backs us up.
I think we already have that support. I mean, we wouldn't have an evening like this if the city hadn't already made that commitment.
I think the mayor is a compassionate mayor that cares about its citizens.
There are a lot of amazing people in Renton, and that just bringing them together in a creative atmosphere can result in like immediate success, potential success.
I would say that the city is involved, the city of Renton in the high level positions are involved in making sure that Renton is a city where the voices of the people can be heard. It's just the continued support that I feel like I'm already receiving in Renton, and even the support of opening up other doors for other people to be a part of Renton. If I just really be serious about it, that's all I need.
I know that I can get the support from the city, especially from the mayor. And the best support that we can get from them is really to be behind us in all the projects that we would plan to do in the future.
Oh, I think it's exciting. I think if you have as much great energy as you did in the room here tonight, you really can make some incredible things happen.
I would like to be very much involved. In fact, I'm thinking of gathering a lot of people in my community, the Filipino-American community, and I really would like them to be a part of this big community.
Yeah, well, sure, I'm one person, but I'd like to spread this information back to the Kennedale Neighborhood Association, get neighbors in Kennedale excited about creating fun and a sense of joy in our community, celebrating what we're doing. And I love what he said, where we all have to have this message that we love Renton. So everyone needs to hear that. You know, we love Renton. So they can carry that message.
Well, I feel like if somebody has to do it, so why not me? You know, one of the things about leadership, I think, is you have to be a bridge. And so being a bridge for me is being someone that I show my family, my kids, my children, and my grandchildren and my neighbors as an example that I'm willing to walk this road. So come on and walk across this bridge with me.
So obviously, no shortage of enthusiasm there with that group. And so we're hoping the next steps are going to be more of the same with more people. Some of the feedback, I'm not going to read all of these, you can read them for yourself, but really from the staff connecting to their actual impact day to day with their projects and work they do, it was huge and it was a really wonderful thing to see. From residents, they want more of this, they want more opportunity, and they want to keep this going and spreading the news, so that's what we're hoping to do. We're hoping for a broader audience. This young lady works on this on 7th Street, I believe, Starbucks. She's got Renton right on her arm.
Mm-hmm.
That's wonderful. She loves Renton I hope that's why she put it on her arm, but for whatever reason, that's the next group. So we know that we put a fire under the people that are already engaged, but they have lots of work already that they're doing. So we want to get out to the next level of people, including younger people. I think that was one of the missing elements along the way, is getting the younger folks involved. And that's hard to do, so we'll be working on that. We're working with the $500 idea group. We're making the shirts. We have a Facebook page. And we're also working to partner with a couple other cities, hopefully to bring Peter back for another engagement. It'll be slightly different, more open. We won't be serving dinner, so we can just kind of open the doors and bring people in who are interested. Again, targeting that next level of engagement. And I'm going to leave you with kind of a recap. This video production is a draft, but the Association of Washington Cities put this together for other jurisdictions to use or to think about doing something like this. So we took our experiment with the GPC, and they're kind of capitalizing on that and making it possibly a tool for other cities to use. So there's not enough Renton footage in here, so I'm hoping the final version you'll see more Renton. But it's a pretty good synopsis of the purpose of all of this and the impact it had. So I will leave you with him.
Love matters. Love is important. Love is central to our identity, central to our relationships with other people. Love is what makes the world go round, to paraphrase there. But not enough people were actually talking about lovable cities. And I was traveling around and I was seeing a lot of cities, and I was meeting a lot of people who are doing things not because they're paid to, but because they had this emotional connection with their place because they loved their city.
The Love of Cities tour was our network's experiment with this concept that we should talk directly about love. That there is an emotional infrastructure as well as an infrastructure that supports a city and a community. We are humans working in government. We are serving humans, and we wanted to express and capitalize on that creative energy, those ineffable human qualities that make us what we are, that make each community and each person unique.
When I talk to city officials, I'm talking to them about the unique role that they play in setting the table to allow for more citizen engagement. And when we invite people into the process to be creative and think creatively about their city, they're going to come up with some stuff that's like, oh, I wasn't quite sure about that. But in the end, I think you're going to be happy because you're going to have some new energy, some new excitement, new people in the game working with you as the official folks.
We have been asking ourselves, every bill we pass, every resolution we do, every budget we approve, where's the fun? We all ask ourselves, where's the fun? Peter's had a tremendous influence on our community.
Every place that we went, we had amazing turnout. City employees got together and tried to answer the question, what makes our city unique? And Peter really challenged us to think of small things that would make a big difference. So we capped it at like $500. If you had $500 to make your city awesome, what would you do? And people had terrific ideas.
The $500 project yesterday is an effort that plays off of Seattle's RainWorks project. And in Seattle, of course, they're putting an application on sidewalks that only shows up with messages when it rains. In Sequim, we often get complaints about raining in Sequim because our motto is Sunny Sequim. And that often happens at the Visitor Information Center. So what we've decided to do is paint sunshine everywhere. So we're going to have a whole bunch of different emblem sunshines throughout our community on sidewalks and in other places as our response to Seattle's effort, as well as something that expresses our love of our sunshine.
I think the thing that I've been encouraged by what he said today, at least, is this idea of looking for small projects and pilot things, so really kind of take chances. One of the things that I think we're going to really work on, we had a school teacher come to us with the idea of a mosaic art that each student would come and put together a little piece of glass that will create this large kind of 40-foot owl we'll put on the side of a building. And so we're anxious to kind of see if that can come to play. I think it'll be something that does everything that Peter wants to do, galvanize the community, create a real statement, and give people something to love.
What resonates with me is how easy it is, how people can just take an idea and run with it if they're given permission to do so or given the opportunity to do so.
Probably the biggest thing that I got out of it was
the fact that government employees can play a role in making a city fun and enjoyable, and he makes a good point in that we tend to focus on the nuts and bolts of the city's environment instead of the enjoyable things.
We do a lot of really good things for our community and for citizens, but we don't necessarily think of it as love notes. We think of it as like, that's our job, that's what we're supposed to do. And I think if you think about it as love notes, you do it with a different intent. You know, you know how they say you can like cook food and you could tell if somebody was doing it with love or if they were just making you a, you know, something to eat. And so it's kind of that same thing, like with the work we're doing in the city and working through this plan and taking the citizens' words and then turning it into actionable actions. If we can like mix in that love, then we're going to get that love back, and there's going to be that give and take between us and the citizens that I think is really going to be exciting to see it kind of unfold.
Start small. The little things absolutely matter. And the little things you can do in a weekend as opposed to forming a committee and having to raise money. No, go to Home Depot, buy the stuff yourself, get some friends, go make it happen.
So, thank you for your time. And if you happen to see any of these folks, there's a lot of people at the city that made this happen, and they worked hard, and so give them a nice high five, and I hope to present another recap the next time we do this.
All right.
Thank you very much. If you have any questions, I'm always
Thank you. Terrific presentation.
Thank you.
That was a lot of fun. Thank you. Any final comments, questions from council on that topic? All right. Well, thank you, and we've got one more topic. I think this one won't take us too long. The Republic Services negotiation update.
Thanks, Council President Corman and members of Brenton City Council. I'm Linda Knight, Solid Waste Coordinator for the city, and I'm here to basically give you a short update about where we're at in terms of implementation of our new solid waste contract. So the contract negotiation is complete. You've already approved the contract. The contract was executed in May of 2016. We're in the process of doing our transition planning, and that's going to be ongoing from now until probably the end of January, essentially. There are all sorts of different pieces to put into play. The new contract services will begin in February of 2017. So I'm just going to kind of highlight the kind of three major areas of our transition planning, those being our billing. We're going to be transitioning to contractor billing, the collection planning, and then our public education and outreach program. So in terms of billing, we had a separate operations and transition plan that's been completed that was brought together and coordinated between staffs of Republic Services and our finance and utility billing staff, and then I just oversaw and facilitated kind of the completion of that plan. The oversight for the actual transition planning and implementation will be completed by utility billing and Republic Services staff. Utility billing and city finance are coordinating that billing transition. I just wanted to also briefly let you know that we, in the contract, and I think I went over this in previous presentations, but there is an element that requires Republic Services to site a local customer service and payment center, and they're in the process of looking at a number of sites kind of in our downtown or on the edge of our downtown area to see what would work for them. This is in addition to a regional customer service center that Republic Services will utilize for customer calls, missed collection, information about waste prevention and recycling, as well as them utilizing digital and mobile applications so that our customer service will be provided lots of different options for different kinds of people who have different needs. Any questions so far?
Questions? Okay, good.
The next big area is our collection, and so obviously transitioning to a new service provider requires a whole fleet of new trucks. Those trucks are placed, they're on order. We have collaboration between Waste Management and Republic Services in terms of developing the routing for our residential and our commercial customers. We're going to try to retain as much as we can with our existing routing, but we're taking in, you know, 4,500 new customers, so there will be some changes for some of our customers. There's an employment fair scheduled in September. As you recall, there was a clause in our contract that requires Republic Services to provide employment for any displaced Waste Management drivers. So they've scheduled an employment fair. They're working with locals 117, it's Teamsters Local 117 and 174. Those are the recycling drivers and the garbage drivers. We're going to get all new commercial containers. Republic Services had the option of buying out the Waste Management containers, but they've looked kind of at the cost and the benefit and decided that it would serve our customers better just to go with all new commercial containers. So that's in the process. I think our commercial customers will appreciate that.
They will.
Yes. I know the containers get a little bit dinged up after so many years of service. I've been told in our most recent meeting that they have received bids on new containers. They haven't chosen which company to go with yet, but that's kind of in works. And then to Council Member Prince's concern in previous briefings about the hot stamp that says Waste Management on our residential collection carts, we have decided that we're going to relabel all of those with a Republic Services emblem that will have the customer service contact number underneath. And that's going to be in addition to all of the education labeling on each of the different types of collection carts, whether it be garbage, recycling, or yard waste.
Is that a sticker that goes over it?
Yeah, it's a label. It's a sticker, essentially, but it's quite large. Okay. And
good.
Identifies it as Republic so okay. That customers won't be misdirected to call the city of Renton. And then finally is our education and outreach plan. We are actually in process of developing this. I meet every other week with Republic Services staff. I suspect that we are following a similar plan to what we used for our every other week outreach with our 2009 contract, which included direct mailings, multiple direct mailings, both print and digital and social media, and we'll have community meetings. The timing of our implementation is a little tricky because we have February 1st as our start date, which essentially you don't really want to use November or December for a lot of your outreach because customers just are not, they're distracted. There's a lot going on for families in November and December. So we're planning on holding community meetings starting in October, and then also following up with meetings in January, and those will rotate throughout the city. We did a similar thing with our 2009 outreach, and they were well attended. Customers really appreciated the fact to have some feedback, but also it was an opportunity for us to re-educate all of our customers about which items go into which container. So, and then we'll have all of our print media that goes out with the welcome packets. And that's essentially my update tonight. I suspect I'll be back in front of you in the fall to give you more updates about where we are in terms of our transition.
Okay, thanks, Linda. Don has a question.
Okay, yeah. With the local office, will I also be able to call it if I want to?
So if you're calling in to Republic Services, it'll be very similar to calling into Waste Management. You're going to be you're going to be directed to a call center. That's a regional call center. It's allowed by our contract. The local center is, if you choose, you can walk into the local call center, pay your bill, get help with waste prevention and recycling tips, look at your account, change service levels, go in and report a missed collection if you're downtown and, you know, you didn't have a chance to call in. So it's looking at, we have different access points for our customers that we don't currently have with our waste management contract. With waste management, we just have the large regional call center. With Republic Services, we'll also have a large regional call center, but we'll also have the mobile application, the website, and then we'll have, for the first time, kind of a walk-in payment and education center. So I think that that's a real benefit to our customers.
I think I'm just a little disappointed because I was led to believe in the negotiations and everything that people would be calling a local number.
I will say that things transitioned while we were in negotiations. So we started out with the local call centers, the truly local call centers, and as we were negotiating, those were buttoned down into, they were transitioning to a regional call center like many of the large hauling companies. We did, however, get a clause in our contract that basically states that if something were not to work with those call centers for the city, that they've made a commitment to move those services back in King County. So, you know, we've got the walk-in center, we've got a commitment from them to move a call center back to King County should the regional call center fail. I've listened to a lot of their information about how their call center is different than Waste Management's call center, and I have a lot of confidence in their ability to implement that, but we'll be keeping, you know, our finger on the pulse with that one.
I mean, and I imagine that's out of state. Call center is not going to be in the state of Washington.
Correct.
That's exactly one of the reasons we changed. But thank you.
Yes.
Any other questions or comments? Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Council, this was kind of a marathon session. Mm-hmm. I want to thank everybody patiently making our way through and staff for the excellent presentations. And with that, the Committee of the Whole is adjourned. We'll reconvene as a council in 15 minutes, 7 o'clock. Thank you.